start talking about the inmate population and the programs that we can provide for them, and some of those things you've got to think about, obviously, from the selfish side, that hopefully that they get better and don't come back, because we're all running out of space, right? But then also you have the humanity side of really making sure that we're making people leave better than when they came. And that's our goal with York County, and I hope that's your goal there as well. So this program this morning is a little different, but I love it. York County has brought them in several times and will continue to bring them in. But it's all about songwriting and using their songs to work through things in their life. Because how many of y'all have inmates that rap, sing, write poetry, whatever you want to say? The guys in maximum security keep people up till 3, 4, 5 in the morning. They're all using music. And when we all think about it, we all use music the same thing. When we have a bad day, what are we typically doing on the drive home? Windows down and music up, right? Because there's something about music that speaks to all of us. And that's the thing that I love about this program. I saw him in 2019 at the AJA conference at the kind of the closing ceremonies. And I had to wait in line afterwards and said, how do I get you to York County? And then later that year, we had them come out. It takes some money out of commissary because inmates pay for it. But to bring them here, and one of the things that I love about this is that they get together with these inmates and in 2 hours write a song. And that's the music part of it. That's the words part of it. And it's just amazing to see that. And the other thing that I love about this, and you'll see all the pictures that kind of flash up on the screen, is the smiles that they have during this program are bigger than I've ever seen them with anything else. So I typically get behind because the whole program, I'm just hanging out with them in the block listening because they work through that story. So they're going to tell you a lot more about what they do. We're going to have some fun because we're going to have music this morning. You can see we got a guitar over there. And he's going to get cranked up. And I hope you guys will enjoy this program. So this is the Beat of Life.
To rise. How you bore your Conference. I hope that you all have been having an enjoyable time so far. I'm not sure what you all have been talking about or learning. I would have loved to have been a fly on the wall at some of your sessions, but I was actually telling our group that I'm really excited because we get to bring the humanizing portion of your conference. If you haven't had that yet, you're going to get it today, because that's what we're all about. And I hope that you just really enjoy all the different people that will be a part of our organization that are coming up to share a little snippet and a piece of our entire story of our organization that is called The Beat of Life. My name is Jeni, and I am the founder of The Beat of Life. And as you'll see from our t-shirts and from our signs behind us, our tagline is Music Can Save a Life. Because we believe that music is so much more powerful than just a form of entertainment. Exactly what Chief Hick said. He's like, you could be our spokesperson, actually, because his whole opener introduction of us really just kind of painted that picture that music is all of our therapy. That, you know, and I always love to ask people, like, is there anybody that has not had a very tough day or an incredibly tough period of life and season that they've been through, and they haven't heard a song that has just spoken to them? Has anybody ever felt that they've been driving along or whatever, and they've heard something on the radio or somewhere, even piped in, and you're just like, I needed that, you know? Has anybody here ever experienced that? I know that, yeah, almost every room that we go in, you know, we don't see a single person that hasn't raised their hand, that hasn't felt that a song has spoken to them. And we have actually even heard stories that a single song can actually save a life, which is where our tagline came from. It came from the story of a man who was feeling so broken that he went out literally to do the unthinkable to end his life. He was going through so much trauma and so many tragedies in a particular season that he just was ready to give up. And so he drove out into the forest somewhere, and he said, I'm gonna listen to one final song before I go. And for those of you that believe in a greater power, I certainly do. I think this was definitely a divine moment, because the song that came on was a song that quite literally saved his life. It helped him to rethink what he was going through and to decide to carry on for another day. And he's still here with us. You know, that is the power of music. It is not just a fun saying. It is truly, there's a lot of science that has come out now about the power of music to literally transform our brains. And that is what we harness at The Beat of Life. So I'm going to share a little bit about what we do. And how we came to York County through Chief Hicks, who is just fantastic, as I'm sure you all know, as he's exiting as your president. But we, at The Beat of Life, we're a Nashville-based organization, and we do harness not just the power of music, but the power of songwriting in particular, as Chief Hicks said. So we merge and bring together the music industry and community, which is really, of course, rich and vivacious in Nashville, and we partner that with vulnerable population groups that can use songwriting and the creating of music, not just the listening to music, but the actual creating of it as a way to reprocess their adversities. We like to actually say that we're literally taking people from their greatest adversities to their greatest hits, and not just in the form of creating a hit. Their songs do get the hit song treatment. We are not writing jingles. We are writing literally commercially viable songs that, you know, you listen to them and you're like, that needs to be on the radio. That's actually better than what I'm hearing on the radio. They're incredible. We're bringing in professional and hit songwriters. You may have seen Jelly roll up on the screen. We're partnering with some major artists for our programs. And so we're bringing in the professionals, but we're helping people to reprocess the adversities and the traumas and to find a gift in those things and to find that maybe those things can even become an advantage. You know, you look at somebody like Jelly Roll, for those of you who are familiar with his story, he was incarcerated for decades since he was a youth. And literally is utilizing that to create his greatest hits in the form of actual hit songs, but also in the form of what he's now doing with his platform and his life as the international spokesperson for the incarcerated population, which is the population that we all are here to serve. And so it's a very powerful thing what we're doing. What we kind of do with all of our different programs is we really tailor them to the populations that we're serving. So we obviously serve the incarcerated, which is what we're here to talk about today, but we create programs for youth, for at-risk youth. We all know that kids are going through things that are just unbelievable, that probably everybody in this room did not experience as a child. The topics and the issues that youth are having to deal with today are just seemingly insurmountable. There's obviously a ton of political rifts. There's, the identity crises that we're experiencing. There's school shootings. There are just so many things that our youth are having to deal with, and also in the public eye with social media being so rampant and impacting people's mental health. And so we work with kids. We go into high schools. We go into youth centers. We work with all kinds of at-risk youth. Population groups, and that program is called our Anthems of Change program. Kids are all about change these days and being change agents, and so we're trying to really help them to harness that in an empowering way and not in a divisive way. We also have a program called Beautiful Minds, and that's for people that are battling mental health issues, depression, potentially at suicide risk. And then finally, we have our Redemption Songs program. And that program is what we'll be talking about today. And that's our program for the incarcerated population, for people in jails, prisons, and also halfway houses that are transitioning back into society. And this program is actually, personally, one of my, the one that I think is closest to my heart. Although I have had battles within my family and each of the different kind of programs that we run that I can relate to. I can definitely relate to being an angsty youth, and I have a history of mental illness within my family. I understand all the different issues that everybody is battling, and a lot of these things that are going on is the hot topics right now in the world. But probably what is one of the biggest stories that I identify and relate with is the impact of incarceration on a family. Because my beginning idea of Redemption Songs was founded in my own personal story. I grew up visiting my dad in prison from the time I was 9 years old until I graduated from college. And so about 12 years, my dad's story was a very high profile one. So my last name is Dominelli, my married last name is George, but my last name as a kid was not one that I could hide behind. And so it was a very high profile media event that went on for almost a decade. And so I grew up not only as the child of an incarcerated parent, but one that was in the spotlight. And that created a lot of issues for our family and for me as the kind of forgotten one. I think the children of the incarcerated are often forgotten. But it also made me, even as a nine-year-old kid, decide to try to find a way to connect with my dad. And so I used music and songs to do that. At 9 years old, I sat down at my kitchen counter, and I didn't really know my dad because he had been building a big multi-million dollar investment banking company worldwide that had fallen. So he'd been busy building that before he got caught in his wrongdoing. And so He said, the one thing that I know about my dad, even though I don't know him very well, as a 9-year-old kid, is I know he loves music. Because he's been driving around in this Porsche and he's been blasting all of these old songs, and that is the one thing that I know is his language. And so for about a decade while he was incarcerated, I wrote him songs, and I copied lyrics of some of his popular favorite songs that I knew were out on the radio and things that I knew could move his heart. And gradually I built my relationship with my dad and built connection with him. I moved his heart through the power of song. And I definitely had no idea that years later, I would be doing what I'm doing now and helping other people to do the same thing. But I also used music as my own personal therapy at that time. I became a songwriter, and I got my degree in social work because I knew that I wanted to help people. But eventually I realized that I could help people and bring in the power of music at the same time. So I started this organization not knowing that the city of Nashville songwriters would follow me into jails and prisons and find the same passion in their hearts that I had for the often forgotten populations that are behind bars that we are serving. It blew my mind. We've got professional and hit songwriters that, you know, they say, man, this is better than that hit song I just wrote for such and such artist. This is like real life that we're writing about. This is a real person's story. And they're understanding also that given the same situation and having grown up in that same place that inmate that they just wrote with did, that could be them. And so it's very, very powerful, mutually beneficial impact on our musicians in the city of Nashville, as well as on the people that we're serving. That's what you're gonna get to see today. We gradually started, we have a residency with the Nashville Sheriff. Sheriff Darren Hall has been our greatest champion since day one. He saw this program when we were volunteering. He said, nope, I'm gonna pay you and I want you in here every week. This is powerful. This is incredibly powerful. And so he hired us. We eventually got some media attention, which brought us to some conventions. And as Chief Hicks mentioned, he was actually one of the very first people to actually get a program in another city started. We had lots of people that came up, hey, we want you to come here, we want you to come there. But Chief Hicks is tenacious. He literally was like, we're gonna actually make, okay, what do we need to do? What's the next step? And he made it happen. And so he's always gonna be incredibly special to our heart, as is York County. Because York County, where the chief obviously resides and oversees the York County Detention Centers, is where we launched our very first out-of-state program. And that's what you're gonna get to see and hear about today, and get little snippets and videos and all kinds of exciting things to get to witness that. We hope that it moves you. I'm gonna end with I'm not really gonna read the quote. I have it in my back pocket or somewhere here, but I'm gonna kind of just summarize it. That there's a really cool quote that I read once in a devotional book that really, I think, expresses what the heart of what we do is, and that is that, you know, when there's a calm prosperity in people's lives, you know, oftentimes they're not really bringing out much entrancing music. But when the storms of life hit, a lot of times that's when you see people that are astonishing their fellow men with the things that they're able to accomplish. They're inspiring the world with those things because they're doing it in the face of so much adversity. And the end of the quote said, you know, those people needed the tempest to bring out the music in them. And that's what I honestly believe about every single one of the people that we serve. That tempest is really bringing out the music in them. And you're gonna get to see that today. So I'm gonna bring up our very first speaker, who you got to hear a minute ago, sing Shine, which is one of my favorite songs to get the party started. And Damien Horne is an incredible artist who has an amazing story. He was literally discovered on the streets of Nashville, became a signed Warner Brother Records artist. He's a TED Talk speaker. He's shared the stages with the likes of John Legend and Keith Urban and zillion other people. And he's going to share a bit of his story and how music actually was life-saving to him. So I give you Damien Horne.
First, I want to say it's an honor to be here. Anytime I get the opportunity to kind of share my story and then what this program is about, I take it as a privilege because it means a lot to me. You see the signs and the shirts that say, because music can save a life. I believe that to be true for myself. I'm originally from, not far from here, right up the street, Hickory, North Carolina, if you know where that is. I was born in a blended family of 12 children, raised by a single mother. And man, it was real evident at an early age that the environment I was living in wasn't like the best, you know, suited for, you know, for anybody to grow up in. And I saw at a young age two of my older brothers be murdered in the streets and two of my younger brothers be incarcerated for 10 plus years apiece. And I started thinking, you know, that was what life had in store for me. You know, when you kind of grow up in those environments, you just think, well, okay, this is what life is. You either die early or you end up incarcerated. But at a young age, I found a passion and a desire for music. And that was kind of the thing that kept me out of some of the avenues that I was watching family and friends go down. And that's why I really believe that music can save a life, because I don't think there was anything necessarily special about me to not be in those situations. I just found somewhere else to channel kind of that energy and that, you know, that direction in my life. And I found it at a real young age. You know, my mom always used to love to sing around the house. She still does it to this day. And man, like, no matter what was going on, if we couldn't, you know, if the lights were out or, you know, couldn't pay the bills, if mom was in there singing, there was something that made the place feel a little bit, you know, calmer and a little more at home. And so I was like, man, that's cool how music can, you know, can do that. So I wanted to be somebody who could create and make that happen in any environment I was in, especially my own, you know, like, so at a young age, I used to write poetry, you know, and this is back in the time, writing poetry as a little black kid in the hood is not the coolest thing to be doing. Nonetheless, it was the way I found, like, my own little, you know, like, sanctuary, and I would write these poems, and these poems later turn into songs that I would start singing. And so I would, you know, I kind of got out of the street life through the Boys and Girls Club. That was like the, you know, the thing that kind of got me out of the street. And when I got there, I remember all these people at this particular place. It was like, man, you have a, you know, a talent. Like, you can write, you can sing. And so I just, you know, they kept, you know, speaking life into that particular thing. And I was like, man, this is what I want to do with my life. You know, I want to take this music as far as I can go. And so back in, now I'm dating myself, back in 96 is when I graduated from high school. And when I graduated high school, I remember thinking what I wanted to do with my life was, like, I just want to be, you know, rich and famous. I want to take this music as far as I could go with it. And so what I did was I worked that particular summer and I saved up about $500 and got a one-way Greyhound bus ticket from Charlotte, North Carolina to Hollywood, California. When I was growing up, if you wanted to be rich and famous, you go to Hollywood. At least that's what I thought when you saw on TV. So I remember when I got to LA and I hopped off the bus, I was kind of ready to take on the world, but I was definitely not prepared enough, you know, with, it takes a lot more than $500, let's just say it like that. And I found myself, you know, homeless there for the next 2 years, you know, sleeping in squats and abandoned buildings and things like that. And I remember during those times just kind of thinking, man, like, life wasn't, like, you know, still wasn't going to pan out for me, man. Like, what made me think that I was going to be able to escape what I was seeing around me? But, you know, I contribute a lot of that to my faith in God. And then also the ability that he had given me with music. And I was always like, that was always my thing to go back to. It's like, God, what should I do now? It's like, look, create, create, create. And that was the only thing I knew to do. So I would create and continue to create. And what happened is that led me to, a couple years later, led me to Nashville, Tennessee. And if you ever go to Nashville, Tennessee, you ever been there, you see people doing what we call busking on the side of the road, where you're sitting out there with a guitar and this kind of playing. And so I was like, all right, that's my first gig. That's what I need to do. So I would sit out there for hours and just kind of play. And one particular night, this guy walks by. He's kind of a shorter gentleman. He has a big old black cowboy hat on and like a handlebar mustache. And at the time, that was like a third of Nashville. This particular guy, he walks by and he stops and he opens up his wallet and he throws $100 into my guitar case. He's like, man, you got some skills. It's like, you know, that original. We kind of start going back and forth and talking. I didn't realize who he was at first, but I later found out it was a guy by the name of John Rich from a country duo called Big and Rich. And he's like, man, I want you to come play with me, man. Like, we got this little place we play up the street called the Pub of Love. You know, we got microphones and everything. You don't have to sit out here on the street. So that's kind of what I did. You know, I started hanging with those guys. I met Big Kenny, Gretchen Wilson, James Oliver. The list kind of goes on and on from there. And within about a year of being in Nashville, you know, I went from playing on the side of the street to, like, being on tour with these guys, opening up for Hank Williams Jr. So that was, like, one of those moments where I know is a divine encounter where, like, God just kind of set these things up, you know. And music had continued through this whole time to be this kind of this avenue of weaving my way through life and through this journey. And so I went from there. I got my first publishing deal, and I've been doing music ever since. I've traveled the world multiple times. I've been signed to Warner Brothers, multiple record deals. I can list names all day about who I play with and those kind of things. But I think the most important thing for me is that a new idea or a new aha moment happened for me in the midst of all of that. It was just like, man, like, these things are cool, but the cooler thing is, like, when I think back of how music used to affect my mom and my family in these, like, very, like, you know, desperate moments, and how it could change the atmosphere. And so I was like, man, I really want my music to do that. So it kind of gave me a new trajectory on how I wanted to create and the songs I wanted to create. And maybe about almost maybe a decade ago, I came across the Beat of Life, and I found out what they were doing in prisons, you know, and writing with inmates. And I was like, man, that's what I want to do. I want to create music that's impactful, that can touch people's lives. And so I had the opportunity to go in and manage. It literally, like, hooked me the first day. You know, like I said, I had two brothers who were incarcerated for over a decade. And I remember putting money on books and phone calls and the whole nine, writing the letters, you know. And then so just to be in there and then just talk with these men and these women about their stories. And then, like, watching, you know, maybe some of the hardest criminals, you know, smile or, like, break character, so to speak, and like, really open up and share their stories. And then we put that down. And then it becomes something that motivates them, you know what I'm saying? Gives them an avenue to channel whatever that they're going through. And so I was like, man, that's what I want to do with my life. And I feel like that's what God has called me to do as a person, you know, is like to take this tool. At first, when I was growing up, I thought it was to be rich and famous. I learned out really quickly that I feel like this tool was more about, the purpose is more about others, you know? And so music had, and the people who have come along who have done that for me have been heroes to me. And I was like, that's what I want to do. That's what the new president is talking about, like heroes. You wait sitting in a room full of heroes. And this is kind of my way to be a hero to others. And so I wrote this song called Somebody's Hero. This is on my first album, but it just kind of talks about discovering what you're here for and then, like, locking into that. And I really believe that for me, creating this music and being a part of this program is what that is about. This is called Somebody's Hero. I guess you can say I am afraid of men. I haven't been. I guess you may feel that I haven't been real, just hiding from everything. But the way of the world is waiting on me. Stop wearing my heart on my sleeve. 'Cause I was born to fly, born to shine. Gotta find the better man in me. Dying to live this way.
thank you. Thank you.
Damien opens up our shows so many different places. He has been with us for about a decade, but I completely forgot about that one, and I think that was so perfect for this room. One thing he's also great at is reading the room and figuring out what you all need, and I think that was perfect, and I hope that was special to you all. This next artist that I'm going to bring up here has been a finalist on American Idol. Anyone out here watches American Idol? She is fantastic as an artist and as a performer in Nashville, and as a very young one, she got noticed on American Idol, and by a lot of, she's got a lot of things going on film and TV, Netflix shows. She's actually becoming a character on a Netflix show as, you know how they have actors that have a singing role? Well, you know, a lot of times they aren't actually the singers. So she's going to be the voice for an upcoming show. Just really cool things going on. She also manages other artists, and but she's going to share a little bit as a female artist on kind of that perspective. You know, a lot of the women that are incarcerated that we interact with in our program are women that have gone through incredible trauma. And they actually are incarcerated not because they are horrific human beings, which is the case for all inmates, for the most part, but because they have made choices because they had to cope with a lot of abuse, a lot of toxic relationships, a lot of trauma, a lot of tragedy and things that have happened to them. And Laurel comes from that background. She uses her music to help heal in the incarcerated arenas, and she's going to share a little bit about her experiences and that power that she has seen. So I give you Laurel Taylor.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
I think she covered it all. I was like, wait, I was going to say all that. That's crazy. God's so good. So I'm actually going to share a song that puts you in a place. I want you to challenge yourself this morning. I want you to forget about the position you're in and that you're human, right? You're just another person on this earth trying to figure it out. Some people are higher than others, but you're still human. You still have trouble. You still have faults every day. And so this morning I want to share a song with you that takes you back to your old house. And what I mean by that, your past. if those window shades could hide the pain and the hurt that I was feeling. Couldn't bring myself to leave. If there was something greater than those four walls holding me, if you're trying to find me, I got out and I moved on. I got a new place where I stay. Finally found my home, and it's so much better than a broken down life in a dead part of town. Yeah, there was my own house, but I don't live there. You see, I've only been with Be Alive for maybe a month. I'm already in the family. And I realized something. You give them a chance, these inmates, to hold the pen and be the author. And they don't get a lot of chances like that. And so the impact, the smiles, the joy, the one moment that might change their life, might just change their life, to walk out those gates and never turn back to their old house. That's why Be the Life is here. And so we can have people that say, oh, that'll never work, or why do we do that? But then what if? What if somebody never took a chance on you? Thank you.
Treat right now, because you get to hear two testimonial stories from two formerly incarcerated individuals that have gone through our program that are here today. I'm going to introduce each of them so that neither of them get lost in the specialness. The first one is Joshua George, who is was a participant several years ago in our program in Nashville, and I'm going to ask him to start making his way up here. And he is going to share a little bit about his story that I think you will really deeply feel after hearing that song. So I give you Joshua George.
I don't think I'm prepared after hearing that song, honestly. I just found out about that song yesterday. But yeah, I was just back in. So I was a participant back in 2018 in DCSO, which is Davidson County Sheriff's Office. And I'd already signed for my time at that point. So another certificate wasn't going to help me in. You know, I was waiting for the prison bus. But I don't know how many people in here are believers, but I am. And when they came in and talked about the program, I felt compelled to be a part of it. And sure enough, like part of me was like, oh man, I really don't like being in front of a bunch of people. And I really don't want to sing a song coming from inside, like share my emotions in front of a bunch of inmates. Doesn't sound like a good idea. But something told me, it's like, well, doesn't my word say that you're a new creature? And I couldn't deny that. So I signed up, went through it, and don't know what to focus on. I guess you go through, I was actually one of the first classes that wasn't just a day. And sometimes we do have to do just a day depending on how the makeup of each place we're at works, but we kept extending it and extending it. But I keep thinking about that song, that old house, because I grew up in a broken home. My dad went to prison when I was 4 or 5 years old for a few years. My mom did her best to try to raise me on her own, which she thought I needed a father figure. So her idea was to get with this guy, make sure you hang out with my son, make sure you're a piece of work thing. And that's the last thing I wanted. And oftentimes, more often than not, there was drug addiction involved. And I remember as a young kid, seeing how life was with the whole family, none of that drug addiction, and kind of like what went along with that. I didn't want anything to do with it, so I ended up being, matter of fact, several points in my life, about between 10 and 12, I lived in a home that was like a cabin in Walter Hill, Tennessee, and somebody had built it, I don't know how long ago, and it was in such rough condition that when my mom's boyfriend's mother passed away, the fire department actually found out about this home, went through codes, and decided they were going to use it for a controlled burn test, like experiments. They burned it down and did their training through that. So that's how rough that spot was. And I ended up going to prison. I did 5 years, 9 months, and I'm skipping around. I would have returned to all that brokenness. The house that I went into after getting out had been ran through, destroyed, and after doing that much time, the main thing you want to, like, for me, what I wanted to focus on was I had all this time resting and thinking about myself. I wanted so badly for years the opportunity to work with my hands, to build something, to create something better. So I came out, was working on that house, and it wasn't so much the work on the house, it was the people involved. I started realizing that, I'm definitely skipping around a little bit. let me see where I go next with this. So, I'm gonna backtrack a little bit. So if it wasn't for those people pouring into me in that situation, being a part of that class, and there are a bunch of different programs in there, and some of them are nice. And I'm losing. I'm sorry, you guys.
You got it.
What I want to point out, what I want to make clear is, a lot of people, they see people in that situation going through incarceration as people are paying for the crime they did. And I want to point out to you that that's your best chance to reach these people that have been struggling through brokenness for a long time, and to pour into those people and give them a chance to see something in themselves that's more than what they've been shown through their lives. Like that. Oftentimes, people would come up to me while I was incarcerated and tell me, like, look, this is what I'm charged with, this is my paperwork, this is the thing. More often than not, I would encounter people in incarceration that were often better than the people I used to work with before I got arrested. And I started realizing it wasn't so much them, in my belief, it wasn't so much them that was the one that got arrested. It was the person they were on their drug of choice, in the groups they were in before they got arrested. And not everybody's gonna be ready to change. I mean, I'm sure all of you see the ones that they just seem like they're not ready. That's why I love it. It is a program. We're here for the people that decide they are ready for a change. And it's not for the whole pod, because some of them, they're just not ready. They will be eventually. But in fact, I went through that program, and back in December, I went to York County Detention Center. It was my first time facilitating the program. And I remember when I was in a jumpsuit, every time I saw someone in plain clothes, I thought, man, these people, they're better than me. They've got it all together. I messed up. And when I was in there in plain clothes talking to people, I wanted to let them know, I'm like, just because I'm in this and you're in that, you've got just as much to give them as what I do. And people, I've never been thanked so much in my life. Yeah, I saw these smiling faces, these people just happy to see us, just ready to be poured into. And it's a beautiful thing. I told them, like, I don't want to thank them as much as they thank me, but I'm getting as much out of this as y'all are. And I realized that in that moment, when there is that, you come to your limits, you know, like you just know this is what I'm in control of, this is what I'm not. You do need the people around you. You need someone that cares. And that's what I had through the beat of life. And that's, I would not be here in front of all of y'all if it wasn't for that. I would be back in that brokenness and surrounded by the people that I was what I could do for them. I was just, you know, another resource instead of somebody that I can, I have something to give to people that actually want to give. In fact, Laurel, you talked about the pen. That's something I talked about before. And the old me would have been like, oh, she took one of my lines. That's not fair. But I was thinking, I was like, you know what? That lets me, that's just another tidbit. That's another thing. It's like, that's something that I can give to others. It's something that's worth carrying on. Your song got like messed up this morning. I'm like, come up here like. it's just, I'm trying to think of the next thing now. Yeah, I lost it.
Help those who have been in those places, and they're fresh, they're new to doing that, so you know. But it's so inspiring to see that people that come out of those places not only want to change and get out of their own old lives and their own old homes and all of that, fix all their brokenness themselves, but they also want to actually help other people do that and feed that into others. And that's what both of these men are doing now. I'm going to bring up the next one. Michael, I'm going to ask you to come and make your way to the stage. I also want to make a quick point about Joshua before I introduce our next former participant. Joshua actually is wearing another shirt. That's not an accident. I was hoping, I was trying to make a signal in the back, the shirt that he's wearing is actually our Redemption Songs shirt, and that's a shirt that he actually designed when he was still incarcerated, and it is a picture of, come on up here, do you want to talk about it? Do you want to say a few words about that? Because, this shirt is actually also going to be, we have shirts in the back that are on sale, but you can order this. We actually sold out of this one because it's so powerful. But you can order it. We have an order form in the back if you'd like to order it. He'll explain what it is, though, and you'll have to check it out after this.
Yes, that's one of the things. I'm in the back of the room thinking, like, you've got to speak about this. And then I heard that song, and just everything went sideways. Another reason why I'm here, I was poured into after the program, and got a letter in the mail talking while I was in prison, talking about, like, we're looking for a new logo, a new design idea. And I just threw something together. I'm thinking, okay, they're going to take some of this and fix it around. And she writes me back and says, well, our graphic design guy decided to just go with everything you had. I'm like, oh, no. But while I was still serving time, she told me, and there's a picture of it in that slideshow that was playing earlier, the county jail that I served 27 months in, fighting my case and eventually serving my time, they painted this. Inmates from that correctional, that jail, painted that on the wall. And that blew my mind. I'm like, you gotta be kidding. I did programs in that room. You tell me something I did is on that wall? And I love it. Yeah.
Do you want to explain what it is?
Oh.
Yeah.
Not really. Not quite. So I knew I needed to come with a tagline, and I was thinking, it's like, all right, so we're behind bars, we see bars all the time. We're making music, so it's like, you know, you got bars and music in the musical sense. So I was like, from bars to bars, and like using what you've gone through, and that's what all songwriters do. You know, anybody that's ever created anything, a book or anything, you're going with what you know. So I like to ask people. I don't know, when we were in York County, we're not asking what you did. We're asking, what did you go through? What happened to you? You know, like how did you end up in this situation? And the stories we hear are fantastical, crazy, just thrown together, and there's beauty in it because no two people have the same story, but it all, you know, they have certain elements that all come together. It's just like, I want you to know that whole inmate population, no two are the same. There's good.